Hi, I'm Mark Eaton. I'm from Craig Tool Company, and today we're going to make a raised panel door the simple way. I'm going to show you exactly how to set up the cutters. I'm going to show you how to do the math. I'm going to show you how to cut the boards. And best of all, when it's done, it's going to fit. I think you're going to enjoy it.
If I said to you, by the time I finish this little section of the seminar, you'll be able to do raised panel door math in your head with any size number you want forever, would that be helpful? Never have to pull out a calculator anymore? Somebody could walk up to you and say, my door is 10 by 20, and in your head you can tell them the size of all the parts? Wow, would that be all right? That's what we're going to do first. So, let me get some of this stuff out of the way here. The first thing you need to know, you know, I made this yesterday and I didn't glue it up. That's how much moisture there is in the building now. I guess we couldn't say in the building, in the tent. Let me grab a pen here. First thing you need to know is you need to know what the parts are. Now, when I first started making raised panel doors, I didn't know what the parts are. Well, I shouldn't say that. I knew one part. What part did I know? The panel. I didn't know any other parts. So, again, Sesame Street woodworker. Let's try and bring everything to a level where I get it. The sides are called styles. Side style. S-S. Hey, now I know two parts. Because I already knew which one the panel was. So I've got a style here. Got a style here. I've got the panel, which I knew right there. What's left over? The rails. So that's really the only one you need to learn. Styles are, are sides. Rails are your tops and your bottoms. That's it. Now your cuts, you're only going to make three cuts. So don't think it's that hard. That's why you only have three cutters. Makes life simple. And one of the things that Freud did, I worked for Freud for 3.5 years, did research and development, actually went to Italy. And one of the things that I did when I first started with him, I said, we want everybody to be able to make raised panel doors. So we have to bring everything to simplicity. Because when you get a raised panel set, do you get instructions? No, you get three bits. Then what do? You make decorative kindling until it starts to fit, right? You make very pretty firewood, you cut it off, that didn't work, you try again, you cut it off, you try again until you eventually get fit, then you can't remember how you got there. So then you start all over again. So the first thing I said to Freud, I said, guys, we read from left to right. And they said, see, because I was in Italy. I said, so why don't we rearrange all the cutters so that you understand it? So guess what they've done now? First cut, second cut, third cut. Huh. How many times have you seen a raised panel set where you got a cutter here, and the big one in the middle? Looks pretty in the box, but doesn't make any sense. First cut, second cut, third cut, in order. Now, one other thing with this set here that I'm using, it does come with a little CD for your computer, and it does come with a set of instructions. The math that they do in here has nothing to do with easy. All right, so take this and look at it for the pictures and things like that, but use my math because that'll make it real simple for you. So your cuts. The first cut is the cope cut. Why is it your first cut? Because it's end grain. Anytime you do anything when you're routing, it's end grain first. So your copes, they go on either end of your rails. Your beads are the second cut. That's the decorative frame you see all the way around the panel. So you get a B here, you get a B here, you get a B here, and you get a B there, and your panel's the last cut. That's it. That's all there is to it. Real easy, isn't it? So now let's do the math part. First, I need to know how big this door is. Now, just so that it doesn't look rigged, it's like, well, he could do it in his head because he does the same size as every time. How wide is this door? Pick any number you like. 10. How tall? Anything. I didn't think it was a hard thing. This is just a number. 28. You guys are a nice crowd. Yesterday, we had this stumped demonstrator guy sitting right in the front row. How wide is the door? 19 7/16. When it was all over, he's like, yeah, okay, it's easy. And I mean, I don't care if there's fractions in it. The only thing I don't like is metric. mean, I don't mind metric, but it just doesn't make it as easy. Now, for those of you that are taking notes, take this note right here, markeaton.ca. What I'm showing you here is on my webpage, so you can actually print it all off. All right? The most common problems you have with your style and rail cutter, the 6 most common troubleshooting tips, on my webpage. And as soon as they upload this video that we're filming today and tomorrow, I'm going to have that link on my webpage too. So you'll have the math, you'll have the troubleshooting, and you'll have a video showing you exactly how to do a raised panel door. So there'll be no excuse. So when you're looking at a door that's 10 by 28, there are some numbers that you can put on your chart right away. Now, some of the numbers I'm going to use are dependent on the cutters that I'm going to use. The raised panel cutter I'm going to use today has a back cutter on it, which is this part right here. Okay? You can get a raised panel cutter that looks like this one right here that doesn't have a back cutter on it. This one is easier to use because the distance from the top cutter to the bottom cutter is exactly what you need to fit in the grooves you've made. But even more importantly, this cutter allows you to use standard 3/4 inch thick stock. Now, I say standard 3/4 inch thick stock, meaning if you don't have a planer, you're going out to buy your wood already dressed on all 4 sides. Standard is ish. That means 3/4 ish, which is the wood you're going to buy from the store already dressed. All right, the sign said 1x4. You know that was a lie. The last time that was a 1x4 was when it was in the tree. So you're getting 3/4 ish now. This cutter will accommodate that. If you're using the cutter that doesn't have the back cutter on it, only has the bearing on the top, you should plane your panel stock down to 5/8. So if you don't have a planer, you might have a problem. See, how many raised panel doors do you see where the panel sticks out in front of the styles and rails? None. Because that cutter takes off some from the back, takes the main profile off from the front, this is flush right across here. So you don't have to have a planer. You can just buy your wood already dressed. So one number on the chart we can fill out right now. I have length, width, thickness, style, rail, panel. Thickness is first. Everything I'm going to use today is 3/4. There's one more number you can put on there without even having your first coffee in the morning. That's the length of your style, because they always go from the top all the way to the bottom. Styles are always full length of your door. So in this case here, length of my style, 28. Now I'm going to give you the magic number, the number that will put the math into your head. And the magic number is the width of your styles and rails. And today I'm using 2 3/8. 2 3/8. Now, why did I choose 2 3/8? The cutters that I'm using today, when they cut the groove, cut it 3/8 of an inch deep. So from the outside edge of the carbide here to that bearing right there is 3/8. If you have a set of cutters at home, all you have to do is make a cut, take your ruler, measure inside that hole right there. This one here is 3/8 deep. If yours are 7/16, make these 2 7/16. Now, why do I use a fraction in there? Because, again, I don't want to think. I just want to make stuff. So that's 3/8 there. This is 3/8 here. Those two parts go together. They've just negated each other. So the fraction is now what? Gone. What am I left with? A whole number. Did the math just get simple? I mean, heck, you don't even have to use a second hand. I've got all the numbers right here. So let's finish the chart. And there we go. Length of my rail. Well, if the whole door is, look at that, you guys are jumping all over that already, aren't you? If it's 10 inches all the way across, 10 minus 2 minus 2, 6. Now we have to do the panel. Width of the panel, 10 inches all the way across, minus 2 minus 2, 6. We're going to talk about that one in a second. Length of the panel, 28 from top to bottom, minus 2 minus 2. Anybody know what 28 minus 4 is? How about everybody in the room knows what 28 minus 4 is? Is the math easy? Do you think you could rip your stock to a fractional size, 2n, whatever your cutters are? Makes it easy, doesn't it? So now somebody walks up to you and says, yeah, I've got a door I'm making. It's 20 by 36. Do you have to start pulling out a calculator and a pen and a marker to try and work that out? You can do that in your head now, can't you? The only number I would change is this 6 right here. Why would I change it? You have to allow for expansion and contraction. Okay, I never make my panels shorter because once you cut down a tree, it never grows again. So it's not going to get longer, but it will expand and contract widthwise. So the maximum I would take off would be a quarter inch, and that would be on walnut. That's the one that expands and contracts the most in weather like we're having here right now. Typically, 3/16, maybe an eighth of an inch. So you might want to make this 5 3/4. You know, just take that off, 5 7/8, you know, depending on the wood you're using and how much it moves. But there's your math. Is it easy? Did it just take a lot of the scary part out of raised panel doors? Yeah, you don't have to measure the inside of the hole anymore, do you? All right, now it's time to set up. Now, the next part of the seminar is how to make the cuts. Now, I've said it's going to be easy, right? That means you're going to have to get yourself some high-tech jigs. I brought them with me. High-tech jig number one, 1/8 inch piece of anything. Plywood, Lexan, a door skin, whatever you got that's 1/8 inch. Now with mine, because this has traveled the country with me a lot, I had to write on it, jig, do not use or throw out. Because it's so small, I've got a guy one time standing there, he's drawing, what are you doing? He says, well, I'm just showing this guy how to make a box. That's my jig. Don't want to lose that stuff. High-tech jig number two, piece of 1/4 inch wood. I planed this down so that that would fit right in that hole right there. I don't want to measure anything. I hate measuring. Heck, I don't believe in measure twice, cut once. I believe if you don't measure the first time, you can't make that mistake. How many of you here like measuring? And if you put your hand up, you're probably an engineer or a machinist. Oh yeah, digital calipers, baby. Woo! I finally found a tape measure that is my tape measure. I've been looking for years for a tape measure that I can use because I now have to wear glasses. These are bifocal safety glasses. If you walk around with a 6-inch steel rule in your pocket, the first 2 inches are incremented in what? 1/64. How many of you here can see a 1/64? Do you remember when you could see a 1/64? Yes? Yeah, I was like 22. So I got a new tape measure. Oh, yeah, baby. No writing anymore. I don't have to measure anything. I know the size of things. How big is from here to here? It's that big. What do I need to know a number for? How many times have you seen people try to measure something on an inside corner? They butt it up against the edge there, and then they go like this. And then they count the ticks. What if you're using plywood? Doesn't line up with any ticks on your tape measure anyways, does it? So you're going to set up your cutter to 1.5 ticks. That looks like 1/2. So there's a great tape measure. The last high-tech jig I'm going to use, this one here, I call square with a hole in it. Now, if you go on my website, you'll find the full-size pattern for this one here, or you can go straight to squarewithaholeinit.com. The funny part is when you see somebody in the crowd actually taking notes. Is that one word? Oh, and you need a mug peg, not a shaker peg. Doesn't work the same. Okay, so are we low-tech enough now? Can we make a door without thinking now? Absolutely, and we won't measure a single thing from now on. First cutter, cope cutter. It's that one right there. We're going to chuck it into the router, bottom it out until it touches the motor or the armature inside, then pull it back a little bit. You see, router bits generate a lot of heat. The heat transfers down the shank of your bit. Now, if that shank is touching the motor or the armature inside, where's the heat going to go? It's going to go into your motor. That's going to cause premature wear. So by separating the two, your heat's dissipated by the collet. So I'm going to bottom that out, pull it back, tighten that into place right there. Give that a little twist. Now I'm going to use high-tech jig number one. 1/8 inch ply. We're going to lower that cutter down. Now, this is where you might want to watch the screen there. I'll see if I can line it up. Basically, what you're doing is you're lowering that cutter down until the carbide touches the top of this 1/8 inch piece of ply. So I'll lay that down there. I'll put on something I can see with now. We'll lower that down to right there. I don't know if you can see that. Is that showing on there? Will that show right there better? Okay, so that's what I've got. I've lowered the carbide till it's just resting on the top. I don't want to have the cutter on top of it. I want to have the carbide profile touching the top of this eighth-inch piece of ply. Then you want to set up your fence. I'm going to slide the fence over. I'm going to isolate the bearing. Now you're at the point where you're just putting on a roundover bit, right? You have a bearing in the center there. What do you do when you're setting up your fence on your table? You make the bearing flush with the outside of your fence. Nothing changes. Hold the high-tech jig up against my fence. Slide the fence back till it touches the bearing. Lock it into place. I'm ready to go. All right, so that's set up. I got all my wood here. Going to lay your wood out. What you want to do now is you want to set up your wood so that it's good side face up. And then you get boards like this. It doesn't have a good side. So then you pick the best of the worst. There, that looks good. That looks good. That looks fair. There you go. So there's all your parts. Take a pencil now, mark all your parts. If you want, if you're doing a lot of doors, like let's say you're doing a full-on kitchen, you may want to mark everything, where your copes are, where your beads are. Because you might find that on doors you're making, this style, which could be a small door above your fridge, is the same size as a rail on the door that's over under the sink. Now, what happens if you put a cope cut on one of your styles? You get to go buy more wood, don't you? So, you might want to mark the whole thing out. And then from now on, you're marking on your good side, and you're going to put your good side face down. So every cut from now on is good side face down. So I'm going to take this, just going to make a dot. These are my good sides. So now I'll know good side face down from now on. Take the parts that I'm not going to cut now, set them aside, and you're ready to go. Now, when you're ready to do your cutting, you want to slow your rudder down. When you get into these larger diameter cutters, you don't want to be going 23,000 RPM. You want to run somewhere between 12 and 13,000 RPM, especially on your big cutter. If you're running 23,000 RPM on a 3.5-inch diameter cutter, when you turn that rudder on, you're going to think a helicopter is getting ready to land in your house. And you will not want to do that anymore because you have just gone, oh, my goodness. So slow it down. This is an electronic variable speed router. All I had to do was turn a dial. There we go. Pop that into there. That's 12 to 13,000 RPM. How do I know? It's a C flat for any of you that are into music. All right. That's 23,000 RPM. That's when wood sticks in the drywall if something goes wrong. Catch that tone? C flat, isn't it? I can tell there's a musician back there going, that's not a C flat. Now, when you get home and you want to try this at your house, I would probably make one about this size just for fun. Okay, because your first one ever, if you decide I'm going to redo the kitchen and you're using all of your good wood for your first door you've ever made in your life, tell me it's not going to look something like this. Because if anything goes wrong, you get to go buy more wood again. So you're... All right, relax. Try it first. Make a scrap door first, then start to play. Okay, good side. There's my dot face down, end grain first.
Got my high tech jig here.
There you go. You're a third done. Now, remember that eighth-inch piece of plywood? That is right there. There's my eighth of an inch. That little section right across here. Did I need to know it's an eighth of an inch? No. Did it need to be exactly an eighth of an inch? No. Is it going to work? Yeah. Because I'm going to reference off this from every cut from now on. So let's set that aside. Change bits. We'll unplug the router here. Get that on a hook or something. For now, slide my fence back. Now we're going to set up the bead cutter. Now the bead cutter is pretty much the exact opposite of this one right here, of my cope cutter. And to set up the bead cutter, you're not going to make a scrap cut. From now on, stop making scrap cuts. I know you're saving your scrap so that you can make scrap cuts. You don't have to. If you're making raised panel doors, what do you need to have an extra one for the garage for? You don't. Having a scrap wood door just means you have very pretty firewood. Now, for me, that's what I do for a living. So if you happen to be in Hamilton, 24th of May weekend, we have the raised panel door bonfire. It's a heck of a show. So there is my bead cutter. How do you set this one up? You take your first cut and you use it as a reference. You take this cutter and you set it up so you lower that down till the top of that cutter is flush with the top of your first cut. Not flush with the top of the board, flush with the top of the first cut. So we're going to do what I call the pinky test. Very important test when it comes to high-tech jigs like I use. Pinky test. You carry that jig with you. Now, why is it the pinky test? I find we have a very sensitive pad on our baby finger because we don't use it as much. So you can feel everything. Blow off my sawdust. Lower that cutter down so that it's close. I'll try and get that lined up there so you can see it a little better. Use the micro adjuster. And now, just feel across the top. If you can feel the carbide on the top, you're a little bit too high. If you can feel a lip going down to the carbide, you're a little bit too low. So here I need to lower it just a little more. Oh, that feels pretty good. Lock that into place there. And then we'll run a test. Make sure that we are set up right. So same thing as before. High-tech jig, slide your fence in front of your cutter, isolate the bearing flush with your fence, take these off because it's dragging my fence there, there we go, we'll lock that into place, and now we'll run our test, and we'll run the test on the good wood. Now, how do I run the test on the good wood? All I want to do, I want to cut off this section right here. That is all I want to cut off. Nothing else. That's how you can test on the good wood. Just cut that right there. I don't need to have a scrap piece of wood to try. All right. Plug the router in and then we're ready to go. Let me show you how to run this test. That's it. I didn't even cut off all that. I knew right away where I was. If I have wood left over on the top of that cut, cutter's too low. If I have wood left over in the bottom of that cut, cutter's too high. The carbide on this bit is the exact same thickness or height as that tongue right there. So if I have wood left over in the top right here, and I ran all the way down the side, am I going to have wood left over here? Yeah. So you know what that means? You nailed it. You're dead wrong. You are perfectly wrong. But what do you do with this piece? Throw it away. Because if you adjust your cutter up to take off that extra piece of wood, you just made the groove bigger, the panel will go in it, and it'll rattle around. I haven't ruined anything. I haven't even gotten the part where the panel's going to be. So I've got, it's like perfectly split. You can see there's a little feather wood on either side. I'm set up right first try. Right. That's the perfect pinky test right there. So now, stiles and rails get a cut. There's my dot. That's where my bead is. That's the part that's going to go down and to the fence. So let's cut the rest of these. two-thirds done. Heck, you're closer to finish than you are to start. So what do we have so far? We have a cope. We have a bead. And we have two parts that fit together perfectly. And because you've referenced your good side face down, we have a flush surface across the top, too. Very little sanding to do. Now, here's the cool part about this. If you feel the back, I've got a lip back here. So you know where I bought my wood, right? I mean, that shelf did say 1x4. That was lie number one. And actually, they're not even all the same 1x4. They're all different 3/4 ishes. So now we just have to get into the panel part. So how easy is it so far? Everybody following along? I don't see any deer in the headlights here so far. Everybody's going, I can do this. This is awesome. How's that other piece doing out there? Still going around? Okay, good. I am keeping my eye on it, though. Had that happen once before. I was doing a seminar, pass it around. Guy went like this to pass it to the guy behind him. Guy wasn't even watching what was going on. Took it away. Oh, thanks. Walked away. It's like, sir, sir, sir. No more door. Now, the last cutter we're going to put on is our raised panel bit. So we're going to have to make a few changes here. And the changes we're going to have to make are to the insert hole that I have on the router table and to the hole in the fence. We're going to have to make everything bigger now. So first, let's get this cutter out of here. Raise that up. And we'll get that out of there. And let's take this cutter out now. All right, the back cutter is this part on the back side here. Again, that's how you can use standard 3/4 inch thick stock because it takes a little bit off the top and off the bottom. The biggest difference when you're using a cutter that has a back cutter on it is how you set the bit up. You only get to set it up once. Unlike when you're using one with a bearing where you can raise it up, take a little wood off, try it in the hole, raise it up, take a little wood off, try it in the hole. This one, you can't do that. Because if you make a pass and then raise it up, well, it's already taken wood off the back. By raising it up, you are now trying to put wood back on, and that never works well. So let me show you the third high-tech jig that I've got here for setting up this cutter so that you get it first try, too. Okay, now here's how you're going to set up this bit using this high-tech jig. First thing you're going to do is you're going to find one of your rails. See that one still being passed around? That's a good thing. I'm going to put it into there. I'm going to flip it over, good side face down. And I'm going to fit it right into there. So now when you go to set up, you're not even looking at the bit anymore. You're looking at the board. So I don't know if you can see that on there or not. See how the board's not flat on the table surface right there? See how it's on an angle? So you want to lower it down until it's flat on your table surface. If you go too far, look what happens. It starts to come up on the other side. Pretty simple setup. All you want is that to be flat right there on your table surface. That's your setup. You're welcome. You know, that's the only time when I'm at the woodworker when somebody looks at me and goes like this, and that's a good thing. How many times have you tried to set it up, do the test, and just saved you all the testing, didn't I? All right, so we'll slide this fence in right here. Now, here's the big difference when you're using a cutter that has a back cutter on it. You can't do the traditional multiple passes. Traditional means raise up your cutter, make a pass, raise it more, make a pass. Can't do that. With this cutter here, we're going to move the fence forward. Because we've got the height set up, we're not going to change our height. So by moving your fence forward, you're going to take off a little bit. And then on the second pass, you'll take off a little bit more. And on your third pass, where your butt up against the rub collar on the inside, that's the final cut. So instead of going this way, you're just going to go 1, 2, 3 and take it off in passes that way. So I'm going to slide that up to about there. Lock that into place. Lock that into place. Make sure that that spins freely. Always sucks when you turn on your router and it's jammed on the back of your fence. little smile from the cameraman there. Now, this is when you really want to have your router slowed down. Okay? Again, sawdust. You guys might get to be part of the show on this first little turn on here. You never know. Think of it like you're at the arena, watching the Canucks, puck comes over the glass, you're going to keep it. There we go. All right, so let's do our first pass. End grain first, just like you're doing a round over. Nothing changes. There's my dot. Good side, face down. Now, another thing, too, when you're doing this, typically you do end grain first, but you don't have to do end grain first literally. You don't have to go across your end grain, then across your end grain, then with that grain, with the grain. If you remember to rotate your board counterclockwise, you have the exact same effect. All right? End grain first. There's your tear out. Rotate it counterclockwise. Cut the tear out off. Rotate it counterclockwise. There's your end grain. There's your tear out. Rotate it counterclockwise. Cut the tear out off. So you can keep your board down on the table surface, too. You know, there's that first pass, and already it's starting to fit into the hole. So we're already on our way to having this exactly the way we want it. So let's finish this. All right, so there's pass number one. We've taken away a lot of the meat. Okay, we've got starting on the backside here. Now we're going to adjust our cutter for the second pass. Depending on your router, that's how much you can take off. Okay, this here is a 2-horsepower router. So I would probably do 4 passes if I were using a hardwood. If you had a 3.25-horsepower router, you might want to do 3 passes. If you want to do 4, great. Keep that last pass so that it's down to maybe a 64th. Because if you're going to route boards and you're going to get a little bit of burning, it's probably going to be right here. So if that last pass is about a 64th or a 128th, tiny little bit, you can actually cut the wood off. Because if you burn the board and you pass it over again, what happens? Nothing. The wood's already cut off. So if it's not cutting off any wood, the router bit's pretty much going, there it goes. Oh, there it goes again. So you have to do some cutting to cut a burn off. But I've seen it a lot. Push, still there. Push, heck. It's going to be there forever. Now, don't worry about the dipping and bouncing and things like that, because on my last pass, everything is going to be straight. Why? Because right now, I'm freehanding it over the hole. I don't have a bearing lined up. I don't have anything to support me in the middle. So right now, when I get to the hole, it's me trying to hold it out. But when I do the final pass, I've got the rub collar, which will be lined up with my fence, so I won't dip into the center. So let's move this over one more time. Now we go back to the high-tech jig. Hold that up against the rub collar there. Slide that back. Lock it in here. There we go. Now let's do our last pass. One little thing, by the way. This is probably going to be the hardest door you'll ever make, is a small one like this. But think of this. Maybe it's a drawer. Okay? Narrow, but long. Why would this be the hardest door you'll ever make? Air. Put your pad here, you're going to tip it up. Put your pad here, you're going to tip it out. Put it too close there, you're going to tip it in. I mean, there are so many things that are going to wobble around here now on you. You have to picture in your mind's eye where the solid stock is on the bottom and make sure you put your push pad and press down at that point. So if you're standing like I am when you're doing your routing, when you run it across, you definitely don't want to do a wheelie coming out the backside. because you've just taken off too much wood. If you stand in front of it and you run it across, you might find that you rotate in and rotate out. So keep your pressure down in the center. Now, when you're all done, you want to take a look at the face, and each corner should be should have a nice straight miter from that tip right there, right out to that tip right here. So when you look at it, occasionally you might see one that drifts off. Then you almost have to CSI. It's like, okay, well, what did I do to make the drift? Well, the drift could have been as you were coming through one side, you thought, okay, I'm done, and you pushed out a little bit, just a tiny dip, which took off too much material right there, and now you're perfectly flat along here, and you've got the little drift there, okay? So, yeah, I always want to make sure that everything's nice and tight and flat when you're done. But now you've got everything set up. You know, I don't have to think. Fits in the hole because the cutters are already set up for me. I don't have to worry about flush because everything I did was all lined up, all good side face down. So now it's time to assemble. Thank you, sir. All right. When I'm ready to put it together, I tend to stand my parts up. Why? Because then I have something to push into. A lot of times you'll put them all down, lay them on your workbench, and then you try and squish them in this way, and the glue's drying, and this way I can push things into it. I will also brush glue on here. When you're gluing this up, you want to have glue across here, there on the profile, here, 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 and there. Don't miss a spot. And when you're brushing your glue on, brush outwards. Never brush inwards. Because if you have a little bit of glue as you're brushing inward that goes inside there, that's where the panel is going to go. So if all of a sudden that glue touches that panel, it's going to glue it to the rail. Now, what did I say right at the beginning about expansion and contraction? This board is going to expand and contract this way. If it's glued into place, where's it going to go? It's only going to go one way. It's going to break something trying to push out the other side. So always brush the glue on so that the glue is brushed outwards. And if you have a little bit over on here, no big deal. Once you put it all together, just sand it off or trim it off or whatever you want to do. So I'll brush that all on. Then I'll take the part and I'll tip it into place like so. And then I'll press it down into the style and make it flush on the outside edge. Press that in there. I never put this part here on next. I always work so that things are open and easy to get it. If I put this one on here next and something's not exactly right, now I have to try and slide this into the hole. So what will I do next? Put on my panel. Now your panel doesn't get any glue. So just lay that into there. I'll put my glue on this piece here. Step that up like so, give it a bit of a tip, make sure it's flush right there, take my last board, again, your glue is already on those rails, stand that up there, give a little tip into here, press it down in, make sure it's all flush, and there's the door. There. No, I do these a lot, so that wasn't really a big deal for me, but thank you. But that's how easy doors are. Do you think you could do them now? Do you think for those of you that have done doors before, you'll take less time to do them because there's a whole lot less setup now? Absolutely. There's not a whole lot of scrap wood left in your shop, too, because you're using your real wood to do all your testing. But doors are easy if you take all the stuff you've learned from all the manufacturers that want to have their own way of doing it and make it easy. You don't need any special high-tech jigs. And think about this. Let's say you're going to make a blanket chest. If you're going to laminate all that wood together to make it like 36 by 18 or whatever, why not make raised panels? Because if you're gluing and waiting for glue to dry while that big hunk of pine dries, you're making the panels, and now you might have four raised panels on the front of this blanket chest. What would look better? if it's that easy, it's the same amount of wood. You know, you're just taking that wood and popping it into different parts. So now you can make that blanket chest. You can make the side of a jewelry box. You can make a whole lot of things. This could be the lid of something, whatever you want it to do. But raised panel doors are not difficult. Do yourself a favor, though. If you haven't bought a raised panel set and you're thinking about it, get a good quality one. I was in Windsor, Ontario. I was doing a seminar down there. I saw a set of raised panel bits, three cutters, $36. Had to buy them. Had to find out what was wrong with them. You know, how can you sell three bits for $36? Well, because that cutter there, the carbide on every one in every set was brazed on crooked. So that means at 12 to 13,000 RPM, that cutter is pretty much spinning like this. Now, what do you do when you get home? Oh, honey, I'm going to redo the kitchen. I'm so excited, and I got a really good deal, honey. Because you remember, you got the Minister of Finance has to say yes to all this stuff. So you go home, you got the set. No. I didn't have to spend $200 like at the show. All I had to do was spend $36. So you make your kindling. You put the parts together, but they don't fit. Because remember, that hole there is bigger now because the cutter's doing this. So you go, oh, okay, well, first try. I probably didn't know what I was doing anyway. So you try again. Didn't fit. So then you go online. Then you read a magazine. Then you talk to your buddies. Then you go to the woodworking club. And then you go back online again. And then you go to YouTube and watch a video. And then you try it again because you have knowledge, baby, and it still doesn't fit. So what do? As men, we take the kit, we put it in a drawer, and we don't go there again. Heck, wouldn't want to return it to the store because they're going to try and make me look like an idiot. No, they're not. They're going to go, oh, look at that. It's brazed on crooked. Here, let me get you another set. Men, we have to learn to take things back. Companies will not stop selling cheap Chinese junk if they don't get any returns. Women, you guys are amazing. You'll return anything. Oh, my gosh. And you'll ask for more because of the hassle that you went through. Women are brutal. Women are tough customers. And, you know, the nice thing about raised panel sets, because they don't come with manuals, we don't have to worry about it. Right, guys? We weren't going to read them anyways. So we're at Craig, we're actually considering starting to call all of our manuals womanuals because we know they will read them. Guys are going to take the manual out and put it in the manual drawer. So, like I said, markeaton.ca, the math is already there. The problems that you might run into with your style and rail cutters, the troubleshooting tips, are already there. Tomorrow when we shoot the video, it will be on a link from my page to this video, and it'll walk you through the setting up and the close-ups and all the rest of it. So there shouldn't be an excuse for you to not go home after all of this information is on you and try your first raised panel door. Now, if you have any questions, my booth is right down the end of this tent here. I'll be down there in the Craig section in a few minutes once I clean up here. I just want to thank you all for coming, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the show. Thank you very much. Thank you.